You're listening to the Naked Bible Podcast. To support this podcast, visit nakedbiblepodcast.com and click on the support link in the upper right-hand corner. If you're new to the podcast and Dr. Heiser's approach to the Bible, click on New Start Here at nakedbiblepodcast.com.
Welcome to the Naked Bible Podcast, episode 285, Evil and Satan with Archie Wright. I'm the layman, Trey Strickland, and he's the scholar, Dr. Michael Heiser. Hey, Mike. We finally got Archie on our show.
Yeah, finally is the right word for it. It's been a long time.
It has. We tried to do this last year because some of our listeners may realize he was at our first annual conference.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And we did, you know, it just didn't work out, but, you know, we kept thinking about it. So it worked out this time.
And this is just a reminder that our second annual conference is just around the corner. We still have a few tickets available, so go to nakedbibleconference.com. It'll be here before we know it.
Yeah, I know. It is coming up. I'm looking forward to it.
Well, Mike, we've got some exciting news. We've got a book that we'd like to talk about. It's called One Big Family in the Heavens and on the Earth. What's that about?
It's a kid's book. I mean, I get asked all the time, hey, are there kids' books about, you know, divine counsel, worldview stuff? That's in my books. And there are two women on the East Coast, Sue and Laurel, and they have written this book. It's for it's aimed at, you know, preschoolers, you know, that age, just a short little, you know, paperback kids book with illustrations, you know, that nice, you know, kid friendly artwork about what went on in Eden and sort of the Old Testament story up through the Tower of Babel. But again, with sort of a divine counsel framework, you know, where Eden is God's home and the cherubim and all that sort of stuff. But it's specifically aimed at little kids, you know, real small children. So this is the first of, you know, what we hope, you know, that we hope there'll be others. But this is their debut effort to take my content and make it digestible for really small children.
Yeah, it's exciting. And again, it's called One Big Family. You can look for it on Amazon. So please go leave a review if you get it. And we look forward to more books, and it's very exciting.
Yeah, we and, you know, again, you know, we do want to plug the book. You know, we're trying again. Sue and Laurel asked us, you know, to help them publish the book. So we're publishing it through Naked Bible. Naked Bible Press is the imprint. And it would really, really encourage them if you went out and bought the book. You know, we obviously want, you know, all the authors that we bring on here to, you know, get a benefit out of this, but this is really unique. This is the first of its kind, and it would really encourage them to have you pick up a copy, order a copy on Amazon, encourage them as they, you know, are going to work on trying to make the content friendly, you know, to kids of a very young age. I get lots of emails about, hey, you know, how do you do this? Or, hey, is there something like this? And the answer used to be, hey, I don't know, and no. But now the answer is yes. This is something that you can use either for kids or grandkids just to sort of get them started on thinking about the Bible the way you know, we really need to conceive it, you know, thinking about the text through the eyes of the original author and the original recipients. So this is a good place to start.
Yes, and it's just another place to help support what we're trying to do here at the Naked Bible. And we're excited with Naked Bible Press, what other projects we're going to have in the future. So it's exciting. It's you know, good news, Mike. I can't wait to look forward to the next books that we can publish.
Yeah, I mean, hopefully, you know, we'll be able to convince some people to, you know, like give us conference papers or just stuff like that. I mean, anything that's really going to be pertinent and helpful. But again, for me, you know, I as soon as this was proposed, I thought, yeah, this is something we really have to do because there just literally is nothing in the space. So there's stuff in that other space that I just mentioned, but there's nothing here. And so, you know, we're just hoping that this is a successful enterprise.
Yeah, Naked Bible Press is something that you and I have talked about for 2 years now. So it's exciting to see it. Finally, this year is going to be huge. We got other things coming, and
And, you know, while we're on it, you know, there may be somebody out there that has taken supernatural or unseen realm, you know, and tried to maybe produce notes for a youth group or produce lessons for a youth group. I mean, that's the kind of stuff that if we can publish that, are certainly willing to take a look at it and help promote it. It just needs to be done. There's just nothing in this space.
Well, there is now. It's called Naked Bible Press. So there you go, Mike.
Right.
All right. Well, let's just jump in with Archie Wright.
Well, we're thrilled to have Archie Wright with us on the podcast, finally. Archie spoke for us at the conference last year, the first Naked Bible conference, but we didn't manage to get him on before that. So, hey, at least we got you on before the second conference.
Yeah. Better late than never, right?
Yeah, really. Yeah. Hey, well, you're gonna be new to a lot of people in the audience. If they've read Unseen Realm, they're going to have seen your name in the footnotes. The Origin of Evil Spirits was a major work. I mean, you have other things as well, but the whole Genesis 6:1-4 reception tradition and how that fits into Second Temple Jewish demonology. But I want you to introduce yourself as far as, you know, where you went to school, where you're teaching, maybe a couple of classes that you teach normally, and then we will get into the interview and mention your new book. So go ahead, tell everybody about yourself, Archie.
Okay. I currently teach at Regent University in Virginia. My title is Associate Professor of Ancient Judaism and Christian Origins. I did my PhD at the University of Durham in the UK under Lauren Stuckenbrook and Robert Hayward. It was titled The Origin of Evil Spirits, which you can imagine.
Sure.
I did my master's in ancient languages and early Judaism at Oral Roberts University and did my undergrad in New Testament and Old Testament there also.
You know, I have to ask you, what was it like being a graduate student under Stuckenbrook?
It was fantastic.
Good. I'm glad to hear that.
I would highly recommend anyone to study with him. He's probably one of the top in Second Temple Judaism, mm-hmm. Dead Sea Scrolls, Enoch literature especially, which was my primary focus at that point. He's a great person. Couldn't ask for a better supervisor. And also Robert Hayward also. He was fantastic too.
Yeah, I've never met either of them, but I'm more familiar with Stuckenbrook's work naturally. Yeah.
Sure.
And I've heard good things, but I don't know that I've ever really talked to anybody who was under him as far as direction. So that's good to hear. I mean, that's the way it's supposed to be. Somebody who's
he was very hands on. I mean, mm-hmm. he was, you know, I would hand stuff in and he would give it back with, you know,
copious notes.
Yeah. Good ones. You know, sure. So
I'm going to publish my notes on your
work. Yeah, in the end, it was fantastic. Great experience. I know some people have some terrifying experiences with their PhD program and dissertation, but...
That would be me.
Yeah. Durham was great, and Stuckenbrook and Hayward were fantastic. Wow. I was also there with a lot of other really impressive, like Tom Wright and mm-hmm. Jimmy Dunn and Casey Barrett and C.K. Barrett, sorry. Yeah, so there was just a... John Barclay was there. So it was a fantastic scholars.
That's like a heyday.
Yeah. Yeah.
Wow. Cool. Boy, hey, other than The Origin of Evil Spirits, go ahead and mention some of your other books, including the new one, but our audience will be interested.
Yeah. A colleague and I at Regent, Kevin Spahn, did a book on the role of the spirit in biblical interpretation. That was a result of a conference that we did and an ongoing research session we do at IBR. And I also did a two-volume edited anthology on early Jewish literature. It was originally titled An Introduction in Literature, but it got so big we had to go to two volumes and turn to the anthology. But that's been out now with Erdman's for almost a year. It's having a really good reception, and you know, it'd be a great textbook for anyone who's going to teach early Jewish literature in a university or college setting. So it's a variety of, you know, Dead Sea Scrolls, Philo, Pseudepigrapha, Josephus, Apocrypha, and Septuagint, and gives a brief introduction to about 45 different texts from those six areas of literature. The new book I'm working on is about Satan, of all things. People just tell me, yeah, you've done
no surprise.
Evil spirits, you might as well go on and do the big guy, right? So it's coming out with Fortress Press, hopefully in the spring of 2020. I'm in the final stages of it. It's titled The Problem of Evil, the Satan Tradition in Biblical and Extra-Biblical Literature. And it kind of carries from some of the allusions in ancient Near Eastern literature through the Jewish scriptures into Second Temple period literature, the New Testament, and then goes on into the early church fathers, where I think is a significant addition to any research that's been done on the figure before, trying to figure out where we have that transition into this almost autonomous opponent of God in church tradition. So,
you know, I have the two volumes set. And I think, you know, for those in the audience who, you know, they probably have things like Charlesworth, and then there's the short introductions in Charlesworth.
Yeah.
Maybe the old Stone volume, Jewish Writings of the Second Temple Period, that Brill title.
Yeah.
No, that was Fortress as well, I think. But this would be, I mean, I would characterize your two volume set as a significant upgrade, both in terms of just being more up to date, but I think just the material, I think that's fair to say.
Yeah. And I think what it does is, with Charlesworth, it was basically the pseudepigrapha. This has given everyone a really,
broader,
a fantastic overview of six very important selections of texts. With a variety of number from the Dead Sea Scrolls, from a good number of Philo's writings, a good number of Josephus's writings, and so forth. And they're all written and translated by the top scholars in the field. So I think we did a fantastic job with this, as did Erdman's. It took a long time to get it out, but we finally made it.
Mm-hmm. Well, we do want to talk about Satan.
of all things,
you know, I guess in most contexts he gets a little too much attention, but you know, we've got to give him some time here, and this, of course, in conjunction with your specific book, this is why we wanted to have you on. Let me jump in here with a question. Now obviously many in our audience are going to know, or at least will have been introduced to the thought, that the New Testament teaching about Satan underwent development during the centuries that, well, just the flow of biblical literature. You're going to have this antecedent information. English Bibles are going to have various renderings of Hebrew Satan in the Old Testament. Then you have the Second Temple period on in the New Testament. So they're going to know from previous discussions on this podcast, again, a little bit in Unseen Realm, my book, that there's this concept of development. And what I'm wondering is, you know, to a wider audience, now you're a Second Temple or, you know, Jewish origins guy, to a wider audience, both in terms of lay people, but also in terms of like Christian scholars in disciplines like systematic theology, do you find that a lot of them don't realize that there's been this development?
Yeah, certainly. I mean, that's I think that, well, the majority of Christians who kind of focus on the New Testament, that becomes a significant issue. I think one of the first things we have to understand is that there's no single idea of what we would call a Judeo-Christian Satan figure in the Hebrew Bible or Septuagint, the Jewish scriptures. He's understood as a heavenly being for the times that we kind of look at him in this setting as being the Satan. And he falls into what we call a so-called angelic category. In fact, we even see the angel of the Lord acting at times as a Satan.
Yeah. Opposer, adversary.
Yeah, Numbers 22, for example, is the Balaam story that is a really good example there. He also functions in a role that is given to him by the heavenly divine court. In fact, he's, as you know, likely a member of that divine court. If we look at texts such as Job 1 or Job 2 closely, I think we can see that there also. He also appears.
Yeah, I always like to talk about it, and this is a bit, I don't know what's the right word. I'll say it's a bit overstated to call it an office, even though you'll get Semitic guys like Lowell Handy, you know, who will, you know, that they'll flirt with that sort of approach, you know. So it's not completely out of hand, but it might be a bit overstated. There aren't precise parallels, you know, as far as office holders and that sort of thing. But you know, you get that role. There's a role, you know, that either God is using a member of the heavenly host to function as an opposer in some context, or, you know, like even the angel of the Lord with Balaam, obviously, impeding him. But our audience is going to be familiar with that. Like systematic theologian folks, I mean, I've had the experience of having, you know, these are people with PhDs, you know, but it's just a different field. And they'll kind of look at you like you got two heads.
Yeah.
I'm just wondering if you've had that experience even at that level.
Oh yeah. Okay. Yeah, absolutely. I mean, that's not foreign. Whenever you're dealing with, you know, traditions like this, that they're so set on trying to figure out one and only answer to it, you know, and it can only be that way. And trying to explain to them the development of this figure, like you say, and you're leading up to this, I mean, it's so important, the development of this figure. It's not a black and white issue. It wasn't this at this point in time and then became this at this point in time. There's this huge development that we'll talk to, I imagine, later on this. But yeah, I agree with the office thing. I think that's a bit too far. I think there's a function of this being, and I think at times there may have been more than one of them functioning in this role. I'm not sure it's a single one. But we also see this figure acting as kind of a prosecutor in Zechariah 3 when Joshua is brought before the Lord for the so-called questioning as to his worthiness as becoming high priest. I think we see that there also. So it's a multifaceted role that this so-called angelic being, I don't really like that term, angelic.
It's a little imprecise, you know.
Yeah. I like to call them heavenly beings. I think somehow they're, you know, they come from that realm.
Angel is more of a job description and so is Satan. So it's an awkward way of referring to it.
Yeah, I think in general terms though, the term ha-Satan, and that's how the majority of the references are to the figures, ha-Satan. In the Old Testament, does not fall into the category or categories that Christians like to see him today. I think it's just not there to see him as this anti-God figure in the Old Testament. Then when we get to the Second Temple period, we see a further transitioning of that where the term Satan becomes even more enigmatic to the point of almost disappearing from use. But at the same time, there are multiple
substitutes,
other figures who come along, potentially taking up the role he holds, although it becomes a little bit different, a little more vague, so to speak.
Do you think it's figures, or is it terminology for an emerging tradition about a sort of an arch rival or arch enemy? Those are two related things. There's the, you know, for lack of a better way of putting it, there's this entity we're talking about as opposed to the way the entity gets talked about.
Mm-hmm.
You know, do you see either one of those or both? Is a little bit of both, or how do you look at that?
Well, I think it's probably a little bit of both. I think depending on what your approach is going to be, is it going to be a single figure? This Satan as a single figure? If so, then he kind of disappears. But if you kind of want to look at it from the point of view, or perhaps there are multiple adversarial figures. And yet, you know, again, one of our sticking points is terminology. So whenever we hear the word Satan or Satan, we have this Judeo-Christian mindset that goes, oh, I know who that is. But then if you think of that in the terminology sense, where what does the word mean? Mm-hmm. It means adversary. So when you start looking at these other figures or the other nomenclature that's used in Second Temple literature, like Beliar, Belial, Mastema, mm-hmm. Angel of Darkness, Melchizedek, when you start looking at those, are these just other names for a similar type of role that's going on with mm-hmm. the Satan figure from Hebrew Bible? I mean, that's the question that nobody's really been quite able to sort out yet with Second Temple literature. I mean, there's been a lot of really good effort so far. And I have, I think, two or three chapters in the book that are going to be directly related to Dead Sea Scrolls, Pseudepigrapha, Apocrypha, that treat all these various names, specifically how they relate in the scrolls. Who is the Angel of Darkness? Who or what is Melchizedek? Who is Beliar? And so it's something that I think there's a couple of different ways to look at it. And I don't know that there's one that really fits specifically to saying, yeah, Satan becomes this figure in the Dead Sea Scrolls, or Satan becomes this figure in the Pseudepigrapha, because it's just mm-hmm. not that clear with what's going on.
I was going to say for listeners, if you're not familiar with this, again, if you've read Unseen Realm, you should be familiar with this issue. Ha-Satan is a big deal because you have Satan, that's the noun, with the definite article appended to it, prefixed to it, Ha-Satan, the Satan. And in terms of Hebrew grammar, when you add a definite article to a noun, that proper personal nouns don't do that in Hebrew grammar. So it's the same as English. I'm not the Mike. I'm not talking to the Archie. You know, Hebrew rejects that the same way English does. And so when you see it, the, and then a noun, the Satan, it tells you it's not a proper personal name. It's, again, it's either a title or a role or, you know, something like that. It's just not a proper personal name. So that's what generates this discussion. And for anybody listening who wants to get into that, I mean, you could actually put my webpage, drmsh.com, and the word Satan and proper noun or something like that, and you're going to get a discussion of it. So I blogged on that before it was in Unseen Realm. So if this is all new to you, we're not going to drill down on that, on the Hebrew stuff here, because I want to get into the Second Temple material. But if you're already a little bit lost, I recommend reading that, because that's where this discussion or this issue arises from. It's not just a sort of a scholarly oddity. It's actually a phenomenon of the text and the grammar. But how do you, you know, I mean, you teach a lot of students, I guess. Do you do both undergrad and seminary, or where are you at now?
I do primarily seminary stuff, but I do teach some undergrad, but it's generally more, it's not biblical studies. It's more of a
historical,
even theological stuff, but nothing that's going to touch this kind of a topic.
Oh, I was wondering how you, well, you could still answer how you look at it, but you know, when you get into just the concept, not even this topic, I remember sitting I guess it was a seminary class, and I don't remember what the, what precisely the topic was, but when the concept of quote unquote theological development first landed in my head, I thought, well, what do you mean theological development? Like, because I mean, you get this impression
can't be
like doctrines are just handed down, you know?
Yeah.
And they never grow. They never develop. Nothing's ever added. I mean, you know, obviously that part of that thinking is because we aren't taught as believers really anywhere how to sort of do biblical theology, where you start at one place and then you follow the breadcrumb trail through salvation history, and things accrue, you know, they there is development. But I remember the first time I heard that, I thought, what in the world? How can that be? So I was going to ask you, how do you help people understand that? I mean, and maybe how do you understand it if you've never had to sort of shepherd
a
flummox student along with that?
Yeah. Let me correct what an undergraduate, I don't teach the biblical studies, theological side of things. Graduate school and the School of Divinity, I certainly do. So, yes, this is a question I think I can kind of offer something.
Surely you've run into that. Yes. You're in the headlights.
Yeah, absolutely. Yes, I think, of course, this is one of the, I think, probably the more difficult issue when you get in the classroom, trying to discuss with students and folks in a church, mm-hmm. you know, depending on where they lie in the theological spectrum. That's the question mark when you first jump into this kind of thing with a classroom full of students. Where are you all on this spectrum of understanding? You know, is everything set in stone? So that's the thing. And I think at the same time, this may depend on the theological issue in question. You know, how much does this issue affect the person that you're talking to? Mm-hmm. You know, how bad are you going to mess with their world? You know, so I think, looking at theological development, though, I think certainly the issues evolve through periods of history. And I think, you know, my area of, you know, starting in Hebrew Bible and moving forward into the New Testament, I see this development of theological issues on numerous occasions. And I think it's a lot to do with the changing needs of the people groups that are in question of how the theology is developing through various time periods. I think we even see it today in the case of the church, where there are different denominations in question. Theological development occurs differently, and specific issues in particular in various denominations in the church. In the ancient world, though, I think that there are varying viewpoints on things going on in and around the Jewish people, particularly in the Second Temple period. Mm-hmm. And as a result, the development and then the strengthening or even the changing of theological ideas was not uncommon. I think that's something that you can see on a fairly regular basis, you know, starting from Hebrew scripture and then looking how these concepts and ideas were developing into the Dead Sea Scrolls, the communities there, the pseudepigrapha, and so forth on into the New Testament. So I think,
yeah, you know, what are these? I mean, what are these bodies of literature? They're people, the people at Qumran, they're people who take their Hebrew Bible seriously and they're thinking about it.
You know, yeah.
You know, and they write stuff down.
Yeah.
And we can see where they were at any given point and what they were trying to noodle, you know, problems they were, you know, that they saw in the text and trying to understand things. I mean, they're not doing anything different than what, you know, we do now.
No, absolutely.
And so yeah, you know, sometimes I think maybe a good strategy is to take something that's really obvious. Okay. Like sacred space. Mm-hmm. You know, okay, we begin with Eden, you know, God's building his temple and there's Eden, the cosmic mount, you know. I mean, people can sort of understand, you know, okay, heaven comes to earth, God lives there, that's sacred space. And then, you know, you get Mount Sinai, and then you get the tabernacle, and you get the temple. And by the time you get to the New Testament, you know, you have Jesus show up and say, destroy this temple, you know, referring to his own body.
Yes.
I mean,
exactly.
That's development. It's so obvious.
Absolutely.
And then believers become sacred space.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
So there's a very obvious development. I mean, that's just, it's hard to miss that, you know,
but
you get that. But it might be useful. I mean, at least I've found it useful to say, okay, now we all sort of can see this one.
Yeah.
Well, there are other topics, other theological topics within the pages of this thing we call the Bible, you know, and just the flow of, you know, community, believing community history here, if we can use real broad terms, that the same thing is happening.
Yeah, let me just show you a couple of examples that happened in the Second Temple period, which you are familiar with. So it's a very short period of time, where, although 400 to 500 years, I guess, in some perspectives, it's not a short period of time, but there's significant developments going on in the theology of the Jewish people this time. So one, of course, that I've written on is the idea of evil spirits. So, you know, like the Satan figure in the Hebrew Bible, I mean, there's very little evidence of evil spirits as most Christians would understand them today. You know, it's just not there. And not until the Enochic text of the Book of Watchers comes along did this idea of the oppressive, tempting, semi-autonomous type of evil spirit seem to have a part in the theological worldview of Jewish people. But it was there, starting in probably the early 3rd century BC and on through. Why? I think one idea to propose is that maybe this is a result or the desire or need of the Jewish people to have a response to the problem of evil during the Second Temple period. You know, they're looking around and go, what's going on with us? What's going on in our communities? And they're asking the question, why are we, your people, suffering? And they're trying to figure out, you know, based on their reading of Genesis 6:1-4, these evil spirits have shown up. So that's part of it.
That's a good example, like especially when it comes to like you used the trajectory of temptation, like personal temptation.
Yeah.
You know, because like the Septuagint obviously is part of the Second Temple period, and they're looking back into the Hebrew Bible, the Old Testament, and they're going to be using terminology. They're going to be seeing things in the Hebrew Bible, and they're going to be called, oh, that's a daimonion or something like that.
Yeah.
Okay, and then that your point is that language for a particular entity. I mean, daimonion might refer to a foreign deity in the Hebrew Bible. And there's nothing in the Hebrew Bible about that particular foreign deity, like tempting someone to personal sin. I mean, maybe there's a sense of in the passage, you know, some passages about a seduction into idolatry or something. But you're talking about in your example, you know, this seduction to some sort of immorality or, you know, personal sin or something like that. But now that we have this label, this daimonion, which itself is neutral. You know, it's just like a spiritual being.
Yeah.
But now some of them are, you know, looking back in the Old Testament, they're bad guys. I'm using the broadest terms possible. They're bad guys. They're not on our side. Okay.
Yeah.
And so then that becomes a useful term to convey this next idea, which is what you're talking about as far as, you know, depravity and personal evil and whatnot.
Yeah.
So there's terminology issues there. There is context, you know, issues like you were just talking about. But I mean, it's kind of the thing when you see kind of what they're doing, you know, looking back into their scriptures, they're taking their scriptures seriously. And then they're talking about it in a certain way and using vocabulary, then that vocabulary itself becomes subject to, it's malleable. It can get applied in different ways.
Absolutely. And I think the other example is the angels, which you've talked about numerous times, but I think, you know, you see that development there of, you know, that was necessary, so to speak, because of what looked like a changing worldview and theological position of the Jewish people about who God was over against what the Gentile nations are that are surrounding them. I think that's, you know, you've talked about that a great deal, but I think that's another idea where we see this idea of angels and how that theological issue or idea or concept kind of developed from Hebrew Bible, Septuagint on into the Jewish texts and then forward from there. I think, you know, that changes. Well, so
let's take that and talk about some of the terms you brought up earlier. Okay, why would this sense that, okay, again, we're going to use the broadest terms we can. Okay, so back in the garden, you know, or Ezekiel 28 or whatever, you know, somebody who has the whole Hebrew Bible, they're reading it, you know, this is, they're just maybe at the cusp, they're just getting into what we call the Second Temple period. So they're reading their scriptures and they can see that, you know, the humans were deceived by this, you know, supernatural agent, and boy, wasn't that an awful thing? You know, look at the catastrophe this was. And so you don't get a whole lot. You know, some would say you don't get any reference back to specifically, you know, Genesis 3 when it comes to the human dilemma, other than maybe death, the realm of the dead, or something like that. But now you get into the Second Temple period. Why do we get a term like mastema? Okay, like who would have? I'm not going to ask you because it's an unanswerable question. Like, who came up with that?
The author of Jubilees.
Right. You know, like, but why? What do you think is going on inside their head? Like, give us a couple terms and what they mean, but what would be going on in their head to all of a sudden have this term pop into their head? Yep, it fits. You know, I see this term as applying to either the one big guy or something else. What do you think they were thinking about? Like, what prompted, you know, possibly, you know, obviously we don't know for sure where these words initially come from, but you know, what might be the thought process?
Well, I think, first of all, we know it's from the term Masama first emerges in the Book of Jubilees, which is, you know, mid second century BCE Jewish text along the lines of the timeline of some of the Qumran scrolls. So I think you've got the issue of, again, I think they all kind of surround the problem of evil, how they explain what's going on in relation to the oppression of Israel, the oppression of individuals, the oppression of communities. So I think you would know more about the etymology of these words than I would. But I think that, you know, they're seeing probably the term Satan in Hebrew Bible, and they're kind of maybe throwing a new twist or niche to that in their understanding of, well, let's have this lead figure of these evil spirits that we're going to take out of the Enochic Book of Watchers story, bring him into the Book of Jubilees. So now they've decided, well, I think they kind of need a leader. We can't have them running amok around the world. So I think the author of Jubilees is perhaps, you know, seeing, well, maybe this, we could take on this Satan figure from Hebrew Bible and kind of twist that image a little bit and put him over these evil spirits so that they're not out of control, that there's some kind of theological, there's some kind of divine control over what's going on with these evil spirits. They know they're there now. They know, they've read about them, they've heard about them, they're seeing the action of these spirits in the midst of the Jewish people in the Second Temple period. But now the author of Jubilees thinks, well, maybe we should put a little divine sovereignty and a divine authority over these evil spirits. So let's take this Satan figure and put him over them. I think that's kind of what might have been going on.
For sure, like, some of the terms would be almost gestures of contempt.
Yeah.
You know, Belial, that's, you know, worthless one, you know, I mean, so, I mean, that you get some of that. And I would agree that, I mean, again, a sweeping generalization, what upright Jew with a high view of his Bible and a high view of God and God's providential control over things?
Yeah.
That person is not going to look at the other side as evil and just say, it's autonomous. I mean, you know, in other words, God has to have some sort of, there's got to be some kind of check and balance. There's got to be some kind of limitations, because the only unlimited being is the God of Israel. You know what I mean? It's that kind of thing.
Yeah.
So we've got to circumscribe this in some way. And so they're thinking about how that needs to be. And then once, you know, that thought takes hold, well, how do we express that? And that's where you get, you know, some of these other expressions and the vocabulary and the descriptions and, you know, just things like that, that, you know, I tend to think that, I mean, there isn't much. I mean, I know that there's going to be, you know, something, but there isn't a whole lot in Second Temple literature that the data points or the seed thoughts, the little kernels, I mean, that's going to come from the Hebrew Bible, but the things aren't connected. They're not sort of put into a narrative. They're just sort of scattered.
Yeah.
And as people think about what they're seeing in the text, then you know, to add your thought about context, then they look at themselves, you know, like, look at our situation here. They're going to essentially do the exegetical math. You know, they're going to try to put those things together and come out with a coherent way, you know, within their context, within their community of talking about this.
Yeah.
You know, how not only how life is, but how the spiritual component of life, both, you know, good and evil, how that's working. You know, they're going to take they're going to try to address that, you know, and again, that's a very human enterprise. I mean, we wouldn't look at what we do today as either writers or pastors, you know, church leaders, and that we produce things, we talk about things, it's either verbal or written or whatever. Nobody's going to look at that and say, well, you shouldn't be doing that, you know?
Yeah.
You know, it's all of this should be self-evident. No one should be writing or commenting about anything, you know?
Yeah.
Nobody's going to look at what ministry is or the Christian life is that way. But right. Then somehow when you hear a discussion like we're having here about, well, you know, they had to think about that took my 100 years. They finally sort of like, yeah, that's where we want to be. You know, they finally were able to articulate it well. And then you see, you know, development of thought on various topics. Why is that any less legitimate than what we're doing today? Yeah.
Well, I think it's a very key exegetical component of what was going on, you know, in the second and first century BCE within Judaism. They were looking at, and we can see this in the Pesharim, the commentaries on the prophets in the Dead Sea Scrolls, where the authors of those texts are looking at the prophet texts of the Hebrew Bible, and they're putting them into their everyday context. This is what the prophet said. Here's what it means to us. So I think that, you know, trying to put something, you know, a name connecting something to, you know, a theological issue that they're trying to examine, trying to understand in their community context. I think coming up with the name Mastema to try to, you know, control these evil spirits, or, you know, trying to read Isaiah in light of the Qumran community. No, I think this is very much what they were trying to do. It just as we do today with, you know, we're reading the New Testament, we're trying to put it in our context. You know, the thing to keep in mind is, what did the text mean to the community?
And right. They had a context.
Yeah, exactly.
and you would like their context to guide us, you know, as opposed to the other way around. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, that's something that's essentially why this podcast exists.
Exactly.
This is sort of an inside baseball question. I'm not asking you to land anywhere here, but when you talk about the community in the Second Temple considering their own oppression, do you think, when you say oppression, I don't know how to ask this. Again, doesn't matter to me where you come down on this, because this is going to bring NT Wright into the discussion.
I'm not going to answer.
Do you think do you think they still consider themselves to be an exile? Is that what we mean by oppression, or is it the immediate Roman problem? I mean, what do you think?
That's
an inside baseball question.
Well, if I want to land on Tom's good side, I will say, yeah, they're still in exile. Yeah.
I find that attractive. I'm not saying that.
Yeah.
I don't know if it's, you know,
it is attractive, but I think that, I think if you look at exile, they are in exile of not being in the right place where God wants them. If you want to look at it broadly like that, I think maybe you could say that. But have they ever properly come back from Babylon? I don't know that they have.
Yeah, because you get these prophecies that assume or presume that all 12 tribes are going to be restored.
Yeah.
You know, so that's got to be a lingering sense that there's, I like the way you put it, there's just things are not the way they're supposed to be.
Yeah. I think that's clear through all the Second Temple texts for sure. They're just, we're not right. We're not in the right place. Where are we supposed to be? And I think you make a very good point about the entire 12 tribes. That would suggest they're still in exile too.
Yeah. No, really. I mean, that has big implications. You know, let's go back to something a little easier. Like,
of course.
Okay, now you have some Second Temple texts have multiple Satans or, you know, multiple Satans. Do you think that is sort of a generic application of a Hebrew term to just various bad guys? That the point of having multiple Satans is literally no more than that. It's a term that we now find useful just to label bad guys. Or do you think there's something else theologically going on there?
Interesting. I think this may go back to your question on theological development to some degree. I think when you're looking at the Second Temple text, I think it's important that we don't dump them all these Second Temple texts into one barrel. And I think people have a tendency to do that with all these texts. They have a tendency to, I mean, I wish students to talk about the Old Testament as if it's one big book, or are we talking about the New Testament as if it's one big book? So I think the same thing is true of this literature. And I think I don't think there's a significant variety of texts that belong to this period, a variety of sectarian groups writing from its own somewhat unique perspective. Mm-hmm. So all these texts are very different. So we can't really clump all the Dead Sea Scrolls together as they're written by different groups during different time periods, you know, that can vary as much as 300 years with the scrolls. And this is kind of where you're talking about with these multiple satans. It comes from the scrolls and then also the Enoch text too. So I think one has to determine, you know, on an individual basis, how one author is using a term over against another author, you know, the scrolls versus the pseudepigrapha or apocrypha. But then back to your question, how do we understand this depends on, I think, how we define the term Satan. As you know, I mentioned, I think I did anyway, that we have to determine the contextual meaning. You know, does it mean adversary, and that's the legitimate translation of the term Satan, or does it mean Satan, big S? You know, I think that's one of the questions you have to think in context here. If adversary, then yes, there can certainly be multiple adversaries, human and spiritual. So I think we have to realize that even the term Satan in the Hebrew Bible is primarily a human adversary. The majority of the occasions where it's used in Hebrew Bible, it's referring to a human adversary, not a spiritual adversary. But I think there may be more than one Satan operating in the cosmos, in the minds of, you know, the various authors, and perhaps maybe there still are multiple Satans operating in the cosmos. But I think definitely
Depending on what they were thinking and how they were thinking about it. Yeah.
Yeah, I think it all depends on how you define that term. You know, is it a big S, or I hate to even think that way, but, you know, adversary, I think, is the key to understanding that that should be your first stop when you're looking at the term Satan, whether it's in the Hebrew Bible or Second Temple literature, I think even in the New Testament too. Adversary is the key to understanding. But I think part of our problem and part of the problem in our thinking about this figure is that we make him almost omnipresent. So when you start thinking about multiple Satans, to me, that kind of makes sense sometimes. So in other words, he can be anywhere at any time. If you make him the big S, Satan, you know, he's almost like God to some people. Like, he can be anywhere, anytime. He can be here in Virginia harassing me, and at the same time, wherever you might be, harassing you. You know, he doesn't have that power. And I think the Jews in the Second Temple period realize that. And if there are multiple Satans, I think that's a very legitimate understanding for them during that time period. And maybe that's where these varieties of names started to come into play that we see in the scrolls and pseudepigrapha. You know, they were just, rather than confusingly, maybe for them, confusingly using the same term over and over again, then maybe they started to draw in other terms that had variations about what they were actually doing or how they were functioning and so forth.
Mm-hmm. Why do you think, I mean, there's probably half a dozen different possible trajectories to answering this question, but taking what you just said and then going back to, at some point, you have a lead adversary that, how do I want to say this? At some point, there's this perception of the need for order and hierarchy in the hostile spiritual world, and the lead figure, the lead adversary, the lead opposer, you know, is referred to as, you know, the New Testament, Satanas, you know, Satan. Okay. capital S Satan. So why do you think that that made sense? Because that figure gets linked back to the garden, okay? So why do you think, what are some of the possible thought processes for giving, assigning the lead role, or at least preeminence, to that figure? I mean, there's a way I would answer this or approach this, but I'm just wondering, again, what do you think the logic may have been?
Well, I think it kind of goes back to what we talked about a few minutes ago about having the divine sovereignty in place, the divine authority in place, so that things don't just run amok. I think that's probably one of the.
So you would look at elevating the one as sort of a, is it an appointment? In other words, who looked at him as the lead? Is that something that a Jewish writer would say? Well, God sort of appointed this one to wrangle the other ones, or would you say, well, the other ones sort of look at this one as preeminent, or which direction does that go?
Well, I think if you look at the Satan figure, let's say in Job, his task there is to go to and fro on the earth, testing and trying God's faithful or even the unfaithful. Who knows? So now all of a sudden, within the Jewish worldview in the Second Temple period, we have these evil spirits that are suddenly on the stage where they weren't there in the Job story, but they're now there in Judaism of Second Temple period. And their task is similar to what we see, although at times they seem a bit more violent, but that's really hard to say for sure. But I think the authors who decided, well, let's set Satan over these, all they really had to do is look at the book of Job, and they say, oh.
So the reasoning would be that God, ultimately God must have oversight over this. So who would God appoint? Well, you'd appoint this guy.
Yeah, why not?
Okay, that's one potential route that these Jewish writers could have taken to sort of, quote unquote, make sense of all that. Am I summarizing that correctly?
Yeah, I think so. I think they're trying to keep God in control, and this figure is already in the literature. Remember, they're reading, just like they read Genesis 6:1-4 for the development of evil spirits. They're now looking at, well, these spirits kind of need somebody to keep them under control. And if you look at Jubilees, you see this is exactly what's going on. The Satan figure there called Mastema, I mean, he's given permission by God to keep some of these evil spirits that come from the Watcher tradition, mm-hmm. To work with him, in order that he can fulfill his task on the earth, which is to test and to put to trial humanity.
What was it, 10% or a tenth or something like that?
10%, yeah. Which... if you, in some people's minds, there's gazillion demons on the earth today. But, if you think about how many there possibly could have been, based on that, if it's only 10% or left, we're probably lucky.
Yeah. The other thing is, this just popped into my head when you said that. But, I often get that question like in Q&A. And I again, to me, this seems to mean something. You get the... In the Bible, you get this myriads upon myriads, language of the heavenly host.
Yeah.
That's never used of those in rebellion. It's only used of just generic heavenly hosts, like those who are loyal to God. So it would seem to suggest that there's a finite number.
Yes.
A much smaller number.
Yeah, and that's my thought too, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, maybe a Second Temple writer, who knows if that's why they had that thought. I'm just saying that's the thought I have.
Yeah.
But that seems consistent, just a finite, subset, not just this gazillions, like you said.
Yeah. And it keeps things in control. I think that's one of the keys, that they're trying to keep this force of evil, whatever you want to call it. The authors are trying to keep this under some kind of control because God is still sovereign over it. So it can't get out of control. So if there's this massive number of demons running around, so God says, okay, I'll give you 10%, Mastema. That's it. You can use them to fulfill your task. That's it.
Right. That's God's decision to make. It's not
yes.
His.
Yeah. Right.
Yeah. And you, I mean, you could see, again, a second temple writer that, you know, that's a good way to express the idea of oversight.
Yeah.
You could see how that might work. Last question. And you mentioned that your book, and this is different for books on Satan, at least the academic ones that I have, including the early church in the discussion. So a very broad question here. What's different about the way the early church thought about Satan as opposed to Second Temple Jewish communities? Give us an example. What would they have fought about?
Well, I think that what we have to understand about when you get into the early church is, I mean, we've got the apostolic fathers, we've got the apologists, and we get, you know, kind of group them together, I suppose, with their early church fathers. But I think one of the main things you have to keep in mind is why they were saying things and what was their purpose, you know. Their primary response, and you can see this in the writings of Justin Martyr, Irenaeus, Origen, and even all into Augustine, their use of the Satan figure, or the development, is probably maybe even better way to put it, the development, theological development. There we go back to our early question. Yeah. So we're kind of coming full circle here, that their purpose was to thwart the heretical teaching of this, primarily in the Gnostics, that this figure, the demiurge, was kind of another name for the devil or the Satan. He was the bad god. And mm-hmm. So the early church is trying to narrow the power and the authority of this devil / Satan figure in the early church. So I think part of the development that we see there is in a response to the heretical ideas of who Satan was or the power that he had, and so forth. So maybe they're at the same time trying to put a lid on the power, the authority of this Satan figure. But I think one thing we look at, and this, the New Testament, moving on into the early church period in the second century, third century CE, if you can read the New Testament in the same way that you some of the New Testament, the same way that you can read the function or the role of the Satan figure in Jewish texts, early Jewish texts, or even the Hebrew Bible, where his task and purpose is to test and try individuals, the righteous, even Jesus himself in the trial of temptation in the wilderness. I think that's something we have to recognize. So this theological development is still going on even in the New Testament. Then when you get into the early church fathers, this seems to be where this thing kind of clicks, where he becomes an almost semi-autonomous anti-God figure, where I think he's most likely, if you're reading it properly, he's an anti-humanity figure, which was his view of humanity the whole time, running from the Hebrew Bible all the way through the Second Temple into the New Testament. I don't know that he's really, you know, describing him as an anti-God figure is probably not, I don't think, the right language to use. I think anti-human, because he's jealous mm-hmm. of humanity. If you look at the life of Adam and Eve, which is a early second century CE Jewish text, where he rebelled because he was told to bow down to Adam and worship Adam, and he got mad and rebelled and got cast out of heaven along with his angels. And that's kind of the first idea besides Revelation 12, where we see Satan rebelling against God. But he's never really anti-God. He's always been anti-Adam, anti-Adam, anti-Eve. And that's the difference that we see, or the probably a clear understanding of who he should be. He's definitely against the humanity, definitely against us.
Yeah, he's in favor of human destruction.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
That's the platform, you know. Yeah.
I don't know if I answered your question there. I think I got kind of rambling.
No. The demiurge thing is interesting because, you know, to a Gnostic, the evil demiurge is the God of the Bible, and you could see that the how the defenders of the God of the Bible you know, it's interesting how that battle would have played out. You know, you would, you have 2 Corinthians 4:4, you know, just the God of this world, you know, and
yes,
the reference in 1 John as well, you know, so it's, you could see how the two sides could sort of duke it out,
yeah,
you know, in a Gnostic context by appealing. Or by, I don't know what the right word is, appealing to or utilizing, you know, the notion of a main rival, you know, to set them off against each other. I mean, I could see that happening in a Gnostic context.
Yeah,
you know, where they would fight that way, or at least the early church would have an effective rebuttal, you know, against the whole demiurge thing, you know, pasting that onto the God of the Bible. And whatnot. Yeah, I could see that. That's interesting. Go ahead.
But it just seems like the, you know, particularly the apologists, you know, Justin Martyr, he was the first one who made the connection between the serpent in the garden. Although, let's keep in mind, there's no Satan in the garden scene in Genesis.
Right, it's just Nakash, yeah.
It's just the serpent. So he's the first one that makes the connection between the serpent and Satan and the devil and the heretics. So he's battling their original story because he's trying to limit the power of the Satan figure in the garden, whereas the Gnostics are trying to make Satan the reason the material world is evil. It's his fault. He's the one that made it that way. He's the one that created it that way, in fact. So the early church apologists are trying to limit, you know, well, okay, we'll give the devil, we'll give Satan the credit with tempting Eve, okay? But that's as far as it's going to go. He's not going to be this full on. So we'll push that agenda for him, right? So they're pushing the connection between the serpent and the devil and Satan in order to limit his power in the world that the Gnostics are trying to give him.
He's just a created being. You know, at the end of the day, he's a created
exactly.
being.
Exactly. Instead of being God number two, right? Mm-hmm. That's where we see Marcion and his evil God of the Old Testament versus his loving God of the New Testament. That's that same heretical Gnostic worldview that he has, that he's trying to, he tries to give Satan the equality of Yahweh. In fact, he kind of goes along that line of, yeah, he's the bad God versus Jesus is God. So the apologists in the early church period are trying to limit the devil's power. So they're giving him that. Well, okay, we'll let you have the temptation in the garden bit, but we're not going to give you any more of that. So they push that, and that's kind of causes the rise of the Satan figure to take on that role of this tempter of all humanity in the garden, which kind of fits with what we've seen running up to that. You know, okay, his job is to tempt humanity, test humanity. So let's just let him do it in the garden too. And that's what happens.
I'm going to tack one more question on here real quickly. I'm sure you've been asked this in class, maybe even in church, you know, if you've taught, you know, adult Sunday school and in church, and people kind of get to know who you and what you do. But here's a question. Why do we have to read all this non-biblical Jewish stuff? Like, in other words, what's the point? You know, why are you making us do this, or why do you think we should? So how do you answer that again to you know, your undergrad or your?
It's how again, I get my paycheck, Mike.
Right, it's what I get paid for.
Although, yeah, okay, that's as far.
Here's the thumb screw. You know, wear it.
No, but I think, you know, we're 2,000 years away from even the New Testament, right? So how do we really understand that? And I think in order for us to get a fuller understanding of what the Gospels are saying, what the epistles are saying, what particularly the book of Revelation, John's Apocalypse, what's that saying? I think in order to properly understand what's going on in the New Testament, we have to see what's running up to that, like we said earlier, what developments are occurring in the ancient Israel, what's going on in the exiles, the Assyrian and Babylonian exile, what's going on in there, what's going on in the Second Temple period, what's going on at Qumran, you know, and how do those things, it's important for us to know how those things help us read the New Testament properly. I think that's the key. If we just look at the New Testament in a vacuum, we're just not going to understand what the message of the kingdom of God is really about. I think by understanding Jewish theology from the Second Temple period or Hebrew Bible or even the ancient Near East, where we bring in from there and helping us best understand what the message of the New Testament is. And I think that's the key to all this literature. I try to tell my, because, you know, I teach early Jewish literature at Regent, and my students will ask me, so why am I doing this? And I said, well, it's to help you understand what the message of the gospel is. And they said, well, I don't know. I could just do that on my own, can't I? I got the Spirit. I said, okay, fine. You can have the Spirit, but at the same time, you should be intellectually ready to defend. And this literature, the literature of the pseudepigrapha, the literature of the Dead Sea Scrolls, the literature of the Hebrew Bible, helps us better understand what on earth was Jesus trying to say to us? What on earth was Paul trying to say to us? What was Peter trying to say to us? What was John trying to say to us? And I think having the tools in our tool bag to help read the New Testament in light of a Second Temple period context is what we need. And let me just say this. I mean, actually, we're about ready to start a monograph series with Baker Academic on the New Testament in a Second Temple context. Mm-hmm. So we have a list of contributors to lined up to do that. So that's something you can look forward to down the road. But I think it's important. We have to have this context to properly understand what the New Testament is saying to us.
Yeah, I mean, you know, students, and I think just generally, you know, believers, if you ask them to write, give me 1,000 words on what you believe about X, you know, some social, cultural, you know, issue that has worldview, you know, implications. Well, they could produce that. But and then the follow-up question would be, would you like me, when I interpret this, you know, interpret this 1,000 words that you've given me, would you like me to be acquainted with your life and times when I do it? Or can I just wait 10 years or 50 years and then assign, you know, an interpretation to it? Which would you rather have?
Exactly.
Do you want to be taken in context or not is the general question. And, you know, So that's why you're doing it, because the New Testament writers were part of this world and they were trying to answer questions. They were trying to rebut things. There were other things that they read that somebody else wrote that they found really useful, you know, to make a particular point over here or over there. And they interacted with it. They were acquainted with it. They interacted with it. It was part of what they, you know, under the providence of God, you know, what God had them produce. They're interacting with it in a number of different ways, and if we sort of know what they had to think about, we're gonna catch what they're laying down, you know, a whole lot more efficiently.
Yeah.
We'll just become better readers, you know, of the New Testament.
Well, I think
we just sort of lack that.
Yeah, well, I think it's clear if you look at the New Testament, you can see that the authors of the New Testament were reading this literature.
Oh yeah,
you know.
Oh, yeah.
So if they were reading it, I think we should read it too.
Yeah. Yeah, that pretty much cuts to the chase. Well,
yeah.
Well, thanks for spending, you know, an hour with us and talking about, you know, your work and what you do. And again, especially the newest one on Satan. And, you know, Lord willing, when we get to ETS and SBL, you said it would be out 2020, right?
Yeah.
So when the calendar rolls around to that, and when it's actually out, you know, we always do interviews at ETS and SBL.
Okay.
And we'll catch you after it comes out and remind people that, hey, you may have listened to this episode, but now it's here, so go get it.
Absolutely. That sounds great. I appreciate it.
Yep. Thank you.
All right. It's been fun, Mike. Thank you.
All right, Mike, another good interview. Do you happen to have Archie's book that he's known for, and then his second book that's coming out again?
Yeah, the one that he's really known for that you'll see referenced in the footnotes in various places in Unseen Realm is The Origin of Evil Spirits. Subtitle is The Reception of Genesis 6:1-4 in Early Jewish Literature. And that's out in paperback now. It's very reasonable. In the old days, as we like to think, it wasn't. It was very expensive, but it's an affordable book now, and it's great. I mean, it is the best book out on the primary source material for Genesis 6:1-4 in Second Temple Judaism. And this is real recent. This is the other two-volume set that he referred to, is called Early Jewish Literature. Subtitle is An Anthology, Volumes 1 and 2. And again, that I know it's an introduction, you know, an anthology. It gives you overviews on, like Archie said, a whole bunch of Jewish literature within this period, not just the Dead Sea Scrolls and not just the pseudepigrapha, but a whole spectrum. I know it's an introduction, but it's actually, I would call it, it's a good reference work, you know, for a lot of our audience. So if you're looking for a book that gets you into that literature with good bibliography and gives you good summaries about what in the world's the stuff about, it's just a great title.
All right. Well, we're going to follow up with Archie when his other book comes out, and maybe we have him back on.
Yep, the one on Satan.
Yeah, absolutely. All right. Again, don't forget, our second annual Naked Bible Conference is just around the corner. Just a few tickets left. So go to nakedbibleconference.com to get those tickets if you're interested. We hope to see you there. And also, Mike, we got some swag. So go to nakedbiblepodcast.com. And there's an NB store link there in the menu. You can click and go get you a t-shirt or something, or a pillow with our faces on it. It's funny. I can't stress how much fun. I've been threatened.
Have your dog sit on it or something.
Yes. We need to take pictures of it. We need to put Maury on it and take a picture of it or something, because I've been threatening to do this stuff for a long time, and we finally got around to doing it. And so now we've got t-shirts and coffee mugs and all kinds of fun stuff, Mike. It's just fun. I love it. All right. Everyone, again, please go check out One Big Family on Amazon. We'd appreciate it. And with that, Mike, we'll see you next week, and we'll thank everybody else for listening to the Naked Bible Podcast. God bless.
Thanks for listening to the Naked Bible Podcast. To support this podcast, visit www.nakedbibleblog.com. To learn more about Dr. Heiser's other websites and blogs, go to www.drmsh.com.